Okay.
I think it's D.
Okay. I'm going to go ahead and call us to order. We have before us an agenda. On a rare occasion, I don't have any changes to make to that. I want to make one note that there will be multiple iterations under the closed meeting subsection 1 personnel, but we'll talk about that when we get to it. But as it stands, we have before us an agenda. Governing body's pleasure on approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second and discussion. Hearing none, all's in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. We could all rise for a moment of silence, please. And Keith, would you lead us in the pledge, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Our next item is citizens' time. Is anyone signed up who'd like to address the governing body? Anyone? Seeing none, we'll move on. Our first item is presentations. We have associated with the Northern Virginia Community College, Hung Zhu, who is our city rep. Hung?
Hello, I'm Hung Zhu. I'm city's representative to Nova College Board. It's been 6 years since this council body nominated me. I truly enjoyed every moment with Nova. I'm currently serving as the vice chair of the college board, and my term will expire next year. I think I'm eligible for 4 more years after that. But today I wanted to just give you a quick update of the status of Nova. Over the last few years, Nova has become the largest community college in the nation. Used to be Miami-Dade was number one, we were number two. But a few years ago, Miami-Dade started awarding 4-year degrees. So they are not eligible to be counted as community college anymore. So Nova is actually the number one community college in the nation. And we have seen the enrollment dropping in the last few years for various economic reasons. However, Manassas campus still is the only campus or college in the Commonwealth of Virginia that has continued to have a positive growth for the last 3 years. More and more of students going to our Nova Manassas campus. I think the last statistics I've seen from our city, almost 49% of our graduates from high school goes to any sort of 2-year college. And I checked with Ms. Watson, last year we sent almost 60 out of 180 class to Nova. So Nova is very important to the city of Manassas Park, and we hope that we will continue to support its growth. Nova has quite a few initiatives. I'm sure you heard about this, systemic solutions. The college is actually expanding their STEM program from the Prince William, Manassas Park area to all the campuses in Nova. But still, Nova campus is at the heart of this systemic solution. And their initiative tried to become a first research-based community college in the nation, with the idea that will provide a lot of internship opportunities for high school students, which I'm very supportive of that. And there's also another initiative. We work with local companies, a lot of large companies, tech companies, to secure funding. I think there's a push to have more dual enrollment classes with the high school locally. And I'm also, since I'm representing the city, I will work very hard to try to provide the opportunity to local school. The idea is to get the funding and help the K-12 teachers obtain credentials to be able to teach college level dual enrollment classes. Last item I want to update you is, you probably know the President Bob Templin has retired from the college as of February. So we're actively searching for his replacement. And we're coming down to two candidates. One is from North Carolina, one is from South Carolina. And one from North Carolina is actually like a president of all North Carolina community colleges. They have 58 community colleges. He's like a chancellor level, but he wants to come to Nova as the president. We also, the other candidate is from South Carolina, a younger fellow, but really energetic, has a lot of knowledge about how to run a college and try to move forward. So the College Board will meet tomorrow. All information on Nova website, and if you have any opinion or you wanted to somehow let me know, please feel free to go to the website, take a look at it. You will notice we started about 60 applicants down to two. And it's easy to remember. One is from North Carolina and one is from South Carolina. Last item, I talked to the city manager yesterday. I'm glad to learn that the capital contribution from Manassas Park is in the budget. Thank you very much. And I hope the council will continue to support. As I said, the Manassas campus Nova is very important to our community, and I hope we'll continue to have this good relationship going. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Hong. Thank Any you. Questions?
Thank you, Mr. Hsu, for serving on board. I just will mention that I was part of the panel that interviewed the two candidates for president of Nova, and that whoever they choose, it'll be a good candidate because both are really good candidates.
Exactly.
And I look forward to working with that person.
Yes. It would not be a unanimous decision. I think I've done my study, right. Talked to the faculty, talked to various stakeholders. We have different views, but ultimately my view is either one of them will be very qualified to lead us to the next level.
Yeah, and this is major because it's about, you know, making sure we're state number one and we meet the needs of students and beyond. So, yeah.
And feel free to let me know. We have until tomorrow evening when we have our meetings. Ooh. Okay?
Thanks,
Hong.
Thank you. Our next item is a proclamation. It is for Local Government Education Week. With all on our agenda, I'm not going to read the proclamation into the record tonight. We have the proclamation before us. Governing body's pleasure on approval of the proclamation.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. We have no recognitions. Tonight, the consent agenda consists of approval of minutes from March the 7th. Fire department purchase of an air compressor total $44,975. It's a five-year financing, $9,606.32 a year. We have from the fire department a fire marshal vehicle. It's a change in financing. From the NVTA, it's a request for determination about 30% funding. Brazos Technology contract for e-citation system for the police department. Finley Asphalt and Sealing, it's the Mathis Avenue, Mathis Drive. Final payment of $14,916.53. Bellucci Simmons task order number 3 in the amount of $11,500. Those are pass-through funds. And the 2015 Biddy Ball officials invoice, $11,445. Governing body's pleasure on approval of the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. On to unfinished. No unfinished. New business. The first is from finance, a resolution on the general obligation refunding bonds, series 2015.
This is the bond refinance that I spoke with you guys about a couple of times already, that if we move forward with it, it would provide us the potential of saving $500,000 to $600,000 if we chose a targeted savings this year. And overall, scary in here. Do you remember what the overall savings was? Is it
about $1.5 million?
$1.5 million overall savings. So we're asking that you approve this resolution so we can move forward with that refinance.
Any questions? We have a staff recommendation. What's governing body's pleasure?
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. Signal Bay Water Park repairs.
I'm going to ask Sarah Barnett to make this presentation. She's the aquatic supervisor for the Parks and Rec Department.
Hello. We would like for you to propose that you guys. All right, so Signal Bay Water Park is in need of some safety repairs or repairs so that it'll be a safe facility for the summer. One of the first ones would be perimeter caulk for around both pools. It's basically no longer watertight. The water bill for the water park has been drastically increased over the last 2 years. We did a pressure test and we found that there are two leaks on the Lazy River. That repair is $2,200. The outpost and the play features located inside the activity pool have failing concrete. Large cracks have started to form and chunks of concrete have started to fall off of the structure, as well as we also have a crack in one of the water slides. And that repair, there's two options there. The bare minimum for safety is $12,160. But why we have them come out here, because they're coming all the way from Texas, we can get them to do $13,975 of work that would require, would also do a lot of preventative maintenance on some of our water features out there. Like the frog slide tongue is discolored and there's foam starting to become exposed. So having them do everything for the additional $1,800, we'll put everything up to where it needs to be. The tunnel over the Lazy River has several large cracks and the concrete has started to fall into the Lazy River. The cost on that is shouldn't exceed $28,000. They've quoted me a couple of different, but basically once they get in there and they work through, you know, they pull out all the failing concrete, shouldn't exceed $28,000. The vinyl liner in the activity pool is no longer adhered to the bottom of the pool. Wrinkles have formed and it poses a trip hazard. The replacement cost for that is $142,000. The coping stone on the activity pool is pulling away from the deck and the waterline tile is falling off. That's a safety issue because if someone stands on the coping stone, then they could fall in. But also, there's large cracks where toes could get stuck or they're sharp. There's a sharp edge where someone could cut their foot. That is $22,560. However, that's worst case scenario because if we get the vinyl liner replaced, we're gonna have the vinyl liner brought all the way up to the coping stone, so we wouldn't have to replace the blue waterline tile. Mm-hmm. The blue waterline tile on the Lazy River is falling off in large sections. It's no longer watertight, so the cost to repair that is $42,000. As they're replacing or taking off the blue waterline tile, there's gonna be beam and miscellaneous wall repair behind that, because the water has started to leak behind there and corrode the concrete. That, they said budget about $9,000 for that. That's worst case scenario, and they're gonna bill us on time and materials. And then the last one is the deck. A lot of the gravel is starting to show through on the surface. Also, sand is starting to show starting to collect on wet patrons' feet, and then it ends up in the pool. So the cost, we have two options. The first option is to completely demolish the current deck and re-pour a new one, which would be $253,612.48. Or we could go with Sun Deck Coating, which is $105,000, so long as we have a signature to them by April 24th. They give us a discount if we have it to them by April 24th. The department is recommending that we go ahead and do the Sun Deck repair for that one.
So we are requesting at this point that the governing body consider doing all of those repairs before the season starts, and the amount would be not to exceed $379,155. Now that does not include the replacement of the, what is it, the white coat,
and that's an additional $123,000.
Yes, however, we would be coming back to you next year probably requesting that be done at that point. It does need to be done. It's just not quite as urgent as some of these other issues.
Is that above and beyond the $379,000?
How much would that be?
What's that?
How much would that be if we include the white wall repair?
What was the amount of that white wall replacement?
$123,312.
And it would be done by the same company?
Mm-hmm.
Are they willing to give us a little a discount if we include the white wall repair, or no? I'm trying to figure out if they're willing to work with us.
I'm not sure.
So total is about $500,000?
$502,467 if you included it. And we would need to use proper funding to do those repairs.
Well, first of all, thank you very much for the tour the other day. That was very informative.
Thank you.
I got to tell you, this is a very difficult thing for me to support $500,000, and considering we've lost $100,000 combined over the last 3 years, I mean, it's not a money-making proposition, and that doesn't even consider the bonding that was needed when it was originally built. Did Gary get an answer to my question about bonding?
No, and I honestly haven't even talked to him about it yet,
okay.
But we'll work
okay.
on that.
Okay.
Do you know offhand, Gary, when that was paid for or by what funding source? We'll have to do some research on that.
Okay. I mean, I do feel better about it, that effort is being made to increase the cost recovery rate. I mean, that's a positive thing.
Mm-hmm. We do intend to increase the admission fees over there.
Okay.
Are we going to have a target cost recovery of 91%? Is that a goal?
I can't answer that at this point. I need to see where we are and what the direction of the governing body is.
Mm. Any other issues or questions?
Yeah, I have a question.
Preston.
I mentioned this on the tour. There's some underutilized space in the pool area for those who took the tour. It's that sand lot area where you have the benches now, and just for the future, if you can kind of brainstorm and see what you want to do with that underutilized space there, I like to see if we can possibly add another amenity or something extra there that would increase the customer so that it can get on par in terms of the cost. Now the white wall has got to be done. It's going to be done. What has to be done next year,
mm-hmm.
right?
It should be, yes.
See, that's why I was thinking, and I don't want to put Frank on the spot, but we both were thinking.
No, please, go ahead.
To just do it all at once, because it just makes sense to do so. But is there any?
It may save some money if we do that. It has the potential to save some money. Also, if we wait until next year to do it, there is a chance that they would have to undo some of the stuff that they're doing this year in order to go back and do that, and then we'd be redoing the work.
Mm-hmm. So this.
Anyone else?
Yeah, I do. Sorry, I am late, but this was one of the topics in which I did, send an email about it. We've had so many discussions about the Signal Bay Water Park over the past 3 weeks by email. I do support, having the Signal Bay Water Park, but I think we all should be realistic that, the revenue to support the Signal Bay Water Park is not there. Over the past 3 years, or even longer, we've been losing money on this. So I think we need to really think in strategic terms as to what is the future for Signal Bay Water Park. So one of the ways, which I proposed to the governing body is, okay, a little bit of background. I think we are all aware, the land surrounding the Signal Bay Water Park, it's all in Prince William County, and they are looking to approve residential developments there. So at some point, the Signal Bay Water Park is going to be surrounded by residential developments which belong to Prince William County. And the Signal Bay Water Park is not a free service. The whole park is, but the water park, is supported by fee per use. Right now, we are looking at, $400,000, to be exact, $380,000 just for repairs. But in the capital expenditure, for this year, there's $379,000, which we are discussing. But for a medium priority, there's another $1.2 million for the pool, and then an additional $80,000, for other repairs. So we're just, keeping on plowing money into Signal Bay Water Park. I know it's dear to a lot of people. They want to use it. But I think we need to be a little bit more judicious about, the taxpayer funds. Parks and Recreation Department as a whole is supported both by enterprise services, which is fee for service, and there's also a free service, which is open parks. Maybe we may want to look at, splitting the Parks and Rec Department, because the community center, the Signal Bay Water Park, those are all revenue generating entities. And if we keep losing money, then we can't operate it as a business. Whereas the free park and, you know, the neighborhood community parks, those are all free service. That can be supported by residents. I hear from residents because, you know, like when on one hand, you know, like when the taxpayers are supporting the DPR, but then on the other same hand, they also have to pay for these services. So I would suggest, you know, we defer action on this item so we can have a little bit more discussion, think about, you know, what we want to do long-term for this park, and then decide.
Anyone else?
I don't think we have time for that. I mean, we got an April 24th discount they're offering, and after seeing the repairs to the pool, it's crumbling, and it is unsafe, and it has been unsafe. So, I mean, I agree. I think we do need to look at the cost and what we're putting into it, but and that's why they're making the changes to the prices as well as the times to make those adjustments to try to be on par with cost and revenue. But I don't think we have the time to delay it for these repairs.
So this is what I suggested, right? You know, we may want to reconsider making minimal repairs because we are so late in this game and the discussion of the Signal Bay Water Park is happening, you know, so late. Instead of, you know, committing to $380,000, you know, in doing all these repairs, if we decide to go a different route, one of the options which I suggested in the email says basically we may look at, like tearing down the water park and then making it into a full-fledged swimming pool. I mean, if you go to the community center, the swimming pool is used quite a bit. You know, you have swim clubs and, like, reserving, they pay money for it. And then you have other members, you know, who come and use it. While, you know, like with the community center pool is indoor pool, it's, you know, covered, so it can be used 12 months all year long. Maybe we may want to consider, you know, like, I mean, opening up, you know, like, I mean, the Signal Bay Water Park, maybe do some reconstruction, making it into an actual swimming pool, and, you know, like, I mean, trying to, like, I mean, to make it more revenue-generating. Because if you look at it, you know, like, I mean, all the subdivisions which we have around here, both in Manassas Park and outside of Manassas Park in the county, we don't have any, like, I mean, full-length swimming pools. And one of the suggestions which I made is the construction for that pool, you know, like, I mean, doesn't have to be coming through bond funding or doesn't have to be coming from, you know, like, the taxpayer. One of the things, you know, which we have discussed is, you know, like, I mean, because these developments, Caden Ridge and some of these developments, you know, which are coming up, you know, they have in the past offered, you know, some compensation to offset the impact of those developments. Maybe we could use those dollars to construct this.
Mm. Okay. Anyone else?
Please.
Keith?
Thank you. I'll just state that I think that, and I believe that our water park is part of the uniqueness of Manassas Park. It is really who we are. I moved here 14 years ago. At that point, I had a two-year-old or whatever. And in my neighborhood alone of 47 homes, we've watched families come in and out over the years. And anytime there's been little children involved in those families, that is like a huge deal. They find out about it. That's where they go. It's part of who Manassas Park is. Every year I ask the question to whomever it is about repairs and costs and all those types of things. And yes, it does cost money to operate such a facility. And unfortunately, we're in a bad situation. I believe that we can restructure fees. Non-residents pay a little bit more. Residents pay a little bit less. We can figure that out. That's kind of a little bit off topic from the repairs that are needed. We fund a lot of things that are behind the scenes in the city. Police and fire, for one, you know, unless you need their services, it's kind of it's an unseen great part of living in this city, but it's there when you need it. This is highly visible. We rob Peter to pay Paul. We make budgets work, but, you know, to have this close up or be some mosquito pit going forward is just unacceptable in my mind, and I don't think any of the citizens would want to see that either. As far as a new pool, some kind of Olympic sized pool or whatever, I don't see that. That's not going in where the current pool is. That's on another piece of that land, and it's a totally separate thing. It's not like you can change one into the other. I do not want to defer this. We have some dates on the table. We have proffer dollars that we can use that will benefit our citizens, which is why we put this money aside. I am all for spending the money we need to get this done, and I'm all for spending the extra $123,000 this year when we have this company on board. I'm sure we can get some sort of little bit added comp on that, which I don't think would be a problem. So I stand adamantly that we get this taken care of this year and we move forward with opening it up like we have every year.
Anyone else?
I believe the Signal Water Park is an asset to the city. I think we should do all the repairs this year. You've made a profit 3 years ago. The last 2 years, we've been close to 80% cost recovery. We can get close to 90, 95, 100%. We just have to adjust some of our fees. So it is breaking. It can break even, where we can subsidize in a single digit. So I think we are there. I think we should do all the repairs this year. I think it's an asset to the city. I think we need to keep it the way it is, as it is now, and not look at any addition to it.
Anyone else?
Yes. It is an asset to the city. I will grant you that. And I can remember taking my oldest grandchild there when she was 5 years old. We had a great time. I'm trying not to let that influence my decision. The water park is a luxury. We have necessities that need funding. The schools need money. The first responders need funding. The roads, the infrastructure of the city needs funding. You know, and this is $500,000 on top of the 100,000 that we've already lost over the last 3 years. This is very difficult to support. I mean, I honestly could go either way with this. This is from proffer dollars, is that correct? Have proffer dollars, for example, ever been spent on the schools? Have they ever been spent on the first responders? Do we know?
Anything that was approved in the FY15 capital budget that did not have its own funding source from the state or somewhere else, the plan was for proffer dollars to do that. I'd have to go back and look at what was on the capital budget for FY15.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure all of our departments had items on there.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe that is the case with the schools, though.
Okay, it's very difficult for me to spend proffer dollars on a luxury when we are a small, modest income city. We have our limits.
Anyone else?
Yeah, I would like to just echo what Jeanette said. You know, like, we're looking to repair the Signal Bay Water Park, at the cost of $380,000. Whereas if you drive on any of the major streets on Euclid Avenue and Manassas Drive, in fact, at the intersection of Euclid and Manassas Drive, you got those potholes, who are starting to become like swimming pools, and you could be actually swimming in those, You should actually look at, spending money in fixing those potholes instead of, sinking any more money in a water park.
In no way have I suggested that we spend this money and not take care of things like the streets that I drive down, as well as everyone else, that are in horrendous shape. I'm putting aside the other needs of the city at this point and talking about this project in particular. We could sit here and debate all night long where dollars we're going to spend, and we will do that because it's budget season. It's obvious. This is about Signal Hill Water Park, period.
I got a question. And can we actually do this, right? I mean, proffer dollars are used to mitigate the cost of development. So, Dean, this is the question I asked for you. Can we use the proffer dollars to pay for this?
Well, proffer dollars are designed to mitigate the impact of development. They are done in lieu of specific projects. So a developer could have come in and said, okay, we're going to add so many residents. We'll go ahead and reline the pool ourselves. That's a capital expense. So the answer is yes, you can use proffer dollars for this, and that's actually an appropriate use of proffer dollars to pay for capital expenses that are necessitated by a growing city.
All right, we have a staff recommendation before us. Is there a motion from the governing body?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. To what dollar value are we going to, the 379 or the 502-467, as a point of clarification?
I will clarify my motion to include the $123,000 additional that we're going to end up incurring next year, because I believe we can get a bit of a reduction in that cost.
So your motion is for a value of $502,467.
In that general neighborhood,
and
yes.
And that is acceptable as your second.
Yes.
Any other discussion?
Yes. I can see your point of view, Keith. I understand that completely. But yet I can't support it, but I won't stand in the way. I'm going to abstain.
Thank you, ma'am. Anything else?
I'm going to just oppose it outright. As the dean clarified, the profit dollars were meant for mitigating the impact, looking into public services, police, fire, schools. I have seen so much reluctance, in the governing body members, in coming up with money for schools, that they are bursting at seams. Mm-hmm. But then, yet here now, we are readily willing to throw away money literally in water. So I'm going to oppose it.
The only comment I have is that what I'm stating for every part of those, we should require a cost recovery to get close to get that money back. So no one I think here is opposed to funding education, police, and putting additional money. We're trying to correct it so these programs are close to cost recovery. And I think that's the position of the majority of the people in this body.
We're never going to recover $500,000.
If we shift numbers around eventually over a period of time, I believe we can.
We're not going to recover that.
That would be just cooking books, Michael.
It would be cooking books. I've seen it.
Please, one at a time. Any other points of discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed?
One opposed.
Abstentions?
Abstain.
Motion passes with one negative and one abstention. Next item from the city manager is the potential health clinic locations.
And actually, Jay Swisher will be presenting this item.
Good evening.
Hey, Jay.
I'd like to propose for consideration an alternate building location for the current MAP clinic that's operating out of the community center. For the last year and a half, the city, in collaboration with Prince William Health District and the George Mason School of Nursing, has provided free clinic services, acute care services, out of the community center. We utilize two classrooms and a conference room. The clinic will see 25 patients a day, but 50 to 75 patients sit and wait. It's a first-come, first-served type opportunity, so we turn away a lot of the underserved and uninsured citizens of the city. The clinic's been a great opportunity for our community, and the only negative has been how can we see more, how can we provide more service to those community members. Just a few months ago, a great opportunity arose with a grant through the Potomac Health Foundation for $250,000. City applied, and we made it through the first stage of the process. We will find out the final decision on June 5th of this year. But as a result, what I would like to do is provide, I guess, six suggestions for potential locations for your consideration. The sixth location is kind of a newly added one as of last night. So I haven't done a lot of research on that one per se. But the two initial locations are current structures that are already in the city. The last four are sites for modular units. Just kind of a point of emphasis, the grant does allow the opportunity to improve upon an existing structure or procure a new structure such as a modular unit. The health district, I would also like to kind of provide their recommendation or their, I guess, preference. However, they did say that they would be very happy with anything that would be approved as long as we could continue this service. So in your packets, there are pictures of each location. The first location is the Stone House within Costello Park. I do realize that is under lease currently. But again, I just wanted to provide any potential opportunity that is an existing structure within the city.
You were going to have renderings with you today, right? Do we have rendering?
They were supposed to be in the packet, but I don't see them in there.
You can just tell us where they are if people want to share.
Julia, is there pictures. Any chance you could make copies of them?
Yeah. And it's six locations, right?
It was initially five, and he outlined the five in the recommendation in the packet, and then another one was discussed last night that he's going to tack on to the end.
Okay. Thank you, Julia. So I'll go ahead and just describe those. The first is a Stone House, like I said. The second current structure in the city is the house that is directly above the police station that Department of Public Works uses to kind of house their guys during major storms or, you know, major work where they're in the city for extended periods of time. The third option would be a modular site at the bottom of the rear administrative parking lot in the community center that is directly above Lambert Street or Lambert Drive. The next location would be in the veterans lot adjacent to the community center. The next location would be in the lot between the baseball field and the stone house. And then the last option would be in the parking lot there at Public Works, directly behind the bus stop. All of those options do provide water sewer access. In particular, the lot above Lambert Drive in the rear administrative parking lot of the community center was probably the most conducive to water sewer hookup, the least amount of work and, you know, legwork going in to get that set up. That also is the preference of the health district as well as George Mason University, as far as if a modular site is determined to be the best fit. Their number one choice would be the stone house, again, given that were an option. That's, again, their goal is to extend services in some capacity. So any of those options would be a blessing. However, my recommendation to the governing body would be to consider the lot above Lambert Drive as the desired location.
Questions?
Just hours of operation once this would come to fruition. I'm not familiar with it. I apologize.
Sure,
but
no problem. They currently operate 8 to 3. It would follow that same schedule. They currently operate on Tuesdays only. This would be 5 days a week. So it'd be Monday through Friday, 8 to 3. The nice thing about any of the options is it's not going to affect any of their department activities, you know, like our baseball leagues or softball leagues, anything like that. It's going to be during standard business hours when these spaces would not be typically utilized in excess. So any of the options would work well.
So once the structure is identified or created, the cost to the city is maintaining the day-to-day bills of the facility?
The utility cost would be the only cost, the reoccurring cost for the city.
Right.
Insurance. I mean, the city would own the structure and would be responsible for, you know, the structure itself. Everything inside the structure would be insured by George Mason University. And I think the MOU we already have in place, they had referenced, could be modified to add any additional items that would need to be clarified. But the only cost that they really indicated outstanding for the city would be utilities. And they did ask that we provide, our staff provide, once a month cleaning of the site. However, I confirmed there would be no exposure to medical waste, sharps, anything of that nature. That would all be handled by their staff. It would be a 2 to 3 hour deep cleaning, floors, bathrooms, you know, things of that nature.
And you said which one was the number one choice for Mason?
Their number one choice would be the stone house.
Stone house, right.
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Thank you.
Thanks, Trevor.
Did they give you a second choice? Just curiosity.
Well, you know what? Let me back up a second. Technically, their number one choice would be to add on to the community center, but I felt that wouldn't be a gotcha. Cost-effective option.
Right.
I did get that quoted by our former project manager from Shockey. He gave me a rough ballpark estimate of $300,000 to $500,000 to add on 1,800 square feet. But again, given the circumstances with the budget constraints, and I just figured that would probably not be a prudent option.
So, Jay, your recommendation is what we are looking at as Figure 4, which is Site 1, which is at the closest to Lambert. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. That's correct. That lot provides ample parking. It's kind of hidden. It's kind of tucked in down behind at the bottom of the lot there, surrounded by the trees. There's good access coming into the park there, and then obviously the egress at the top coming into Colburn Drive. Won't affect air parking in the main lot of the community center because we obviously get pretty inundated there at times. So this wouldn't impact that. But one of the things the George Mason and the Health District indicate is they want to have connectivity to Air Facility. They feel like a lot of the clients have kind of associated Air Facility with this clinic. So they like being in Costello Park and being close to our building, if at all possible.
Brian.
Question, Jay. Does selection of site influence selection of the modular type of construction? We saw two pictures. One, in my opinion, is more attractive than the other. Does the site selection influence that?
It does not. Well, I'm sorry. Minimally, it would. The site over in the veterans lot would be impacted. And to be 100% honest with you, I haven't really vetted the lot over by Public Works yet, so I don't know if that would be impacted. I would venture not. It just would take up more parking spaces. But the other lots would not. And actually, I have, again, I apologize, I didn't make copies if you want to pass this around. This is the actual unit that they would be aiming for to procure. However, I did find out this morning, I spoke to Dr. Ancher with the district, and they did say that the city would have final say on the building. So if the aesthetics were not, you know, acceptable, they would make changes to find something that was acceptable for the city.
It doesn't look as good as one of those pictures that we had before.
Mm-hmm. So, Jay.
These are a few ones
I've got. Suhas.
Yeah. Jay, I had a question. So, Figure 5, Site 2, which is in a Costello Park veterans lot. What is the downside to that? You know, it's close to the community center. It's also close to that fields there. You know, if they needed airlift, is there any problem with that site?
This site, the biggest kind of, I guess, deterrent, I did consult with Public Works. Their guys were great about coming out and giving me some good feedback as far as their proximity to the water sewer. That would be the most difficult to tap into of the options listed. So I think that would require the most cost up front to kind of make that work.
There's not quite as many parking spaces.
Correct. There's 35 parking spaces right there. None are designated as handicap. I know that's a simple fix, but a lot of the other spaces already have handicap options. But there's only 35 right there. It's good visibility to the community center, so, you know, the connectivity is there. But again, that was the biggest deterrent was the proximity to utilities.
Hey. Any other questions?
Yeah,
not a question, but a comment.
Yes, ma'am.
I agree with Jay's recommendation. I think it's a good location. When we took the tour, it looked good. It felt good. Water and sewer is an easy hookup. It's close to Manassas Drive. It would be easy to draw a map to draw people's attention on a brochure if it needed to be that. So I would support his recommendation for Figure 4, Site 1. Is that it?
Yeah. Preston.
Jay, for Figure 4, are you able to, I mean, people can get in and out. Is there going to be a traffic problem?
I don't think so. They're right off of Lambert. That's a one-way coming up that hill. So, mm-hmm. You know, everyone will be coming. Well, people obviously can come in off Colburn as well, but people can only enter off of Lambert, so they're going to have the option to come up that hill, and then everyone will have to exit onto Colburn. Mm-hmm. So I don't foresee any traffic congestion issues.
Okay. For the design, can they? This is like the. Can they redo the design and make it a little more?
What's wrong with that?
Underneath this one, you see
this one?
The one with the stone. Go to the back picture. I think that was the one
okay,
you liked.
That's better. Brian, that's the one sorry, I was looking at the purple one.
The nicer one isn't in there.
Okay. No, that's the one that they were talking about.
I was like, how'd that pass you guys' desk? And that's get your eyes. Okay, this stone was, this is the one.
No, that's possible from what they said. They would work with us.
I'm sorry, let me clarify. The more aesthetically pleasing ones I just found on my own to try to give examples. The purple one is the one that they
would like to go forward with, due to pricing and due to size, you know, square footage. However, they did say that they would be amenable to any changes that the governing body recommended. The company that they wanted to go through is called Modular Genius, and that was the best option that they provided. However, it's a local company out of DC. However, they can make changes and adaptations. Just for the sake of kind of showing potential options, I just want to throw in a couple extra pictures.
I'm glad I commented on this because, I mean, I like purple. I wore it for Easter yesterday or Sunday, but I don't want a building to be purple. Right. I just don't think it'll look well in the neighborhood. I like this picture here with the stones.
It could be the lighting, Preston.
It could be the lighting, but it's got a purple hue, a lavender hue.
It's probably gray. In reality, it's probably gray.
I'm sure the color can be modified, though.
But, and again, you said they would give us final say on final approval on design.
Those are.
But it's more than the. It's more than the color, though. It's the building, how it looks. This one looks better. It looks more modern. Looks more fit for our neighborhood, and it'll make the neighbors proud that it's there in their community, versus this. And that's what I'm. That's my criteria. So if you can push for this and the little stones on the side, that's really nice and aesthetically pleasing.
Sure. What I can do is I can go back and get a couple options of, you know, pictures that are more representative of that one and then provide it for consideration.
And this grant is coming through us, so, I mean, you all are going to have final approval
okay. On
everything. So
right now what we're really doing is we're deciding the location, not,
you will
not
be
the
asked to
edifice of the building.
Fine later.
Any other questions concerning the location? We have a staff recommendation. It is for, as we see it, figure 4, site 1. What's governing body's pleasure?
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second in discussion. Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jay.
Thank you, Jay.
Okay. Next item are the policy committee nominations. I believe Lana added this for your consideration. Any of you have interest in serving on any of these committees?
What committees are these?
If you go to page 74, you'll find a listing of the committees.
And a description, pages 72 and 73.
Yeah.
Oh, got it.
And if there's no interest, we have not been a strong player in VML issues. There's no requirement that we do this. It's simply a matter if anyone has interest and wants to. Anyone? Then I suggest we pass this by. We'll move on. No interest in subscribing to any of those. Parks and Rec rate increase.
In an effort to increase our revenue stream coming into the community center and the department in general, I would like to propose three rate increases for consideration. The first rate increase would be a 10% bump on all indoor rentals in the community center. Over the course of the last calendar year, I took the calendar year as a data point since I could get a full 12 months annualized, and came in at a little over $250,000 in revenue solely based on our rental sales. So basically, if we implemented this 10% bump, that would equate to about $27,000 in potential additional revenue if those numbers were to stay the same. The next item is Signal Bay Water Park rates. If you look at your column there, there's two options. The first option is a little more conservative. It ranges from zero change to the current rate all the way up to $2 additional. And the second option ranges anywhere from $1 to $2 additional. The big changes are on basically the adult 43 inches and above and the seniors, and then our water walking class, which is a group exercise class. The potential there to reap additional income, again, based on this calendar year's figures, would be anywhere from $7,800 to $23,000. And then lastly, we would like to also ask for approval to increase our birthday party package at Signal Bay. It's currently priced at $170. That includes 10 guests, pizza, cake, cutlery. They provide all of that for the party and up to 10 guests, two chaperones. The increase would go to $200, so a $30 flat increase. And that could potentially add an additional $1,024, again, based off of the revenue figures from this past calendar year, 2014 calendar year. That would allow us to further kind of chip away at that deficit that we did exhibit this past year. But again, there's hopes that deficit's going to further be reduced based on the findings we had with the pressure test showing that we're losing water. I think once we repair those leaks and fix the expansion joints and the light conduits, we're going to see a lot of those utility costs decrease back down to the way rates were 4, 5, 6 years ago. So, you know, potential there is for up to $24,000 plus in additional revenue.
Questions?
Yeah.
Preston.
Jay, how many residents versus non-residents, just percentage-wise, would you guess that use the pool, the water park?
It's kind of tough to say because, you know, we can't differentiate between the two. Is the price has to be the same, I think, because of the annexation agreement. But I would, if I had to guess, Sarah, would you say maybe 80-20, 70-30? 50-50.
And we have made plans to start trying to gather that data during this this season.
Any other questions? Given our previous discussion, it seems to me that option two is where we should go with cost recovery.
Agreed.
Agreed.
Agree.
So with that then, governing body's pleasure on a motion that would approve the increase as outlined in option two for the water park and the 10% increase in the community center.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion?
Yeah, I want to mention that if we're going to treat this like a business, then we've got to, and I understand we have to be scrutinizing of the costs and the revenue, but we also have to support them like a business, and especially when they make initiatives like this to try to adjust their costs or fees in order to cover their costs. So I think this is a good step, and thank you, Jay, for your hard work on doing this.
Thank you.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions?
One abstention. I would like to just make a statement, you know, like when the I opposed, you know, like, I mean, spending, you know, $500,000, you know, like, I mean, on the Signal Bay Water Park. You know, now, you know, like, I mean, once again, you know, like, I mean, without differentiating between residents and non-residents, you know, we are, you know, voting to increase the water rates, you know. So I think, I mean, it's just, you know, like, I'm pouring salt over injury. So I just wanted to say that. I'm going to abstain from voting on it. I hope, you know, like, I mean, you're successful in recovering, you know, like, I mean, the money which we're spending, but I'm going to abstain from it.
So one abstention, motion carries. On to ad tech.
Helen?
Mayor, members of the governing body, last year when we received responses to the RFP for city engineers, Ad Tech was one of the finalists who scored the highest on the scoring system that Public Works used. We recommended them for approval. Then they went to be audited by VDOT for the pre-award audit so that they would qualify to work on federal and state funded projects. The audit, the cost of providing audited rates was more than they wanted to incur. They didn't feel as though they would make that much money. So they worked with VDOT to come up with an alternative to providing audited rates. VDOT has said that they can work at a provisional 110% rate plus overhead. And that would keep them from having to provide audited rates. So at this point in time, we've worked out an agreement. They provided 110% provisional overhead rates to work under, and we would like to go ahead and approve their agreement. They will be able to work on state and federally funded projects, and it will be nice to finally have them on board as another option for the city.
Questions? We have staff recommendation, governing body's pleasure.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Next item is the Fog Concedo conditional use. This is an informational item.
It is. Unless you have questions, there's no presentation on this item.
Sure. I do. Has there been any calls or concern in regards to this entity?
I issued a report to you that I queried the, it's probably at the very bottom.
On the table is a handout.
And I queried the police department, building, fire, and of course my own department, and no calls for service were issued in the first 6 months. Mm-hmm. And there are no issues with the business.
Okay.
So they've done well. I did get a call from the representative a couple of weeks ago asking me if they could get additional pool tables, and I said if he did that, they'd have to amend the CUP. Mm-hmm. I said, won't you sit tight, let's talk again in October, which would be the year anniversary, and then we can look at that.
Why are we delaying on the pool tables if that's something they want to do to enhance their business?
He's allowed to have two. I felt that at the right now at the 6 month mark, mm-hmm. he wanted to expand for another two. That would give him, he'd have to amend the CUP. So I said, why don't you just see how, you know, continue with the business and then let's talk again. So it would cost them money. And, you know, right now they're doing well, so
right.
I felt that it would be best just to leave it as is for now.
Hmm. I've been by, and I checked the place even as recently as Saturday evening. It was well lit. They do have the blackened glass that was of concern with the height, but I could see over, and it was well lit on the inside. I will say that in the times that I've been by, I haven't seen a full load, so I don't know that it would be a significant revenue draw for the other two at this point. If he feels strongly about it, we would certainly entertain an early review if there's some economic reason for him to do it, I think. But so far, it seems to be pretty clean.
So I have a question. How much money would it cost for them to have their cup amended?
Well, they would have to come back, and they'd have to pay for the ads. They'd have to pay the review fee. They would have to pay for the letters and, you know, all that. So they could come back. If you want me to call them back, I will. But it is it's a bit of a detailed process.
I think it's up to the business owner, to be honest. I mean, hey, if they feel like they can spend X amount of dollars and get X plus Y out, you know, I mean, I don't see why we should be waiting 6 months. I mean, it's a blessing this location's been quiet for 6 months, because that hasn't happened for as long as I can remember. So they seem to be doing something right. And if the business owner believes that spending a few dollars will net more, then maybe give them a phone call, let them know what they're in for cost-wise, and see if they still want to move forward.
I just, with the history of the area and the previous businesses, I know it's not fair to and I by no means want to imply that it's not fair to them. I just felt like with this first 6 months was good, let's you know, just continue down that positive path.
So
but
let
I can
me
call them back.
Let me get a sense of the governing body. If the business wants to go ahead and move forward, I think what I'm seeing is let the business go ahead and move forward. We wouldn't get in the way of it, and they could bring the documentation to us. Is that
that's a business friendly approach.
Okay.
I don't think we should be making judging on what the business wants to do. So we can just provide the information. It's up to them to make the decision.
I agree. So they can apply if they want to. Look, please call them back.
I will. Thank you.
Thank you. Manager's report.
Yeah,
so we're going to shift into the budget. Is that what we're doing? Okay.
And I'm going to
going to go over the budget overview PowerPoint presentation, and I'm going to sit back down for discussion. This is brief. It's just an overview. You have the full budgets in front of you, and you also have on top of those a hard copy of this presentation, as well as a tentative budget schedule. And for anybody in the audience that would like the budget schedule or the PowerPoint presentation, this will be on the website tomorrow, Gary? Okay, be on the website tomorrow. Okay, so when we first started these discussions, we knew that there was going to be an almost $2 million increase in debt service payments. We knew it was going to be a difficult budget year. Initially, we had been expecting around 11% real estate assessment increase, but we were conservative, or what we thought was conservatively, planning for a 10% increase. As we got further down the line, we were told it was going to be more in the area of 6 to 8, so we started budgeting for 7.5%, and then we just, Gary just found out a few days ago that the actual number is coming in at 6.7%. Which is not at all where we thought we would be, but it is better than Manassas City, that is coming in at 4%. The budget, you all had requested that we look at the possibility of doing a 5-cent tax decrease. I have a plan for that if you still want to go that route. It is going to have a significant effect on personnel and services, but I won't be presenting that to you here. I will present it to you at a later time in closed session, because it does involve some intensive personnel discussions that aren't appropriate for open session at this time. For this budget that's being presented, we are not proposing any increase or decrease in the real estate property tax. We're proposing that it remain the same. Again, the assessments are up 6.7%, and we have an additional $1.9 million increase in debt service payments. We are not implementing any new programs at this point, other than a tuition reimbursement program within the HR department that I do believe is necessary for some targeted training that we really need to put in place for succession planning purposes. We do have a solid waste fund deficit that we are going to have to get back up to zero there. We looked at several different options for COLAs for employees. As you know, the schools are doing 2% across the board for their employees, or that is what they're going to be proposing. We did look at 2% for employees. We looked at a tiered structure for COLAs with lower paid employees getting 2 to 2.5%, and then the department heads getting as little as a 0.5%. We came up with several different options. At the end of the day, it would be difficult for us to do anything. As it is now, we are going to be looking at a reduction in force and some position restructuring, and that's just to get the budget balanced with a flat property tax rate. That's before we did any type of tax decrease. And we will be also looking at a targeted hiring freeze for several vacant positions. Another thing that we're faced with is a health insurance increase of 7%, which is pretty significant for us. This kind of shows you how the dollar's broken up here. As far as our funding sources, we get 65.5% of our revenues from property taxes, 12.8% from the state. Other local taxes come in at 12.5%, charges for services 4.2%, admin fees 2.9%, and then other revenues 2.1%. This slide shows you how that money is spent. Right now, our tax rate for real estate property taxes is $1.55, $1.55. 70 cents of that is going to the schools, 27 cents to our public safety departments, DSS and other government services received 17 cents of that, Parks and Rec 12, our debt service is 12 cents, regional services 10 cents, and public works 7 cents.
Just a quick question.
Mm-hmm.
So the city debt 12 cents, does that include the school and the city portion of the debt?
The school's 70 cents includes their debt and the 12 cents is our debt.
Why don't we break that out, you know, Gary, because it's been several years, you know, since we took over, you know, looking at the school portion of the debt, you know, we should probably start showing that, you know.
It's under tab 6, page 47 of the budget document.
Budget.
We also show the separate general fund under tab 3, page 39. We show the amount for city debt, the amount for school debt that's transferred to the debt service fund.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, can you repeat the page numbers?
Page 39 under tab 3. It's showing the general fund side of it, the transfer, and then page 47 under tab 6 is the debt service fund.
But that doesn't show, you know, what's a breakup of the tax rate which goes for, you know, paying the debt service for the schools. It just shows the dollar amount which we're paying. You know, I was looking to see, of the $1.55 tax rate, we show that, you know, 12 cents of that, you know, goes to pay the city debt service. And, you know, like, when I was trying to look and figure out how many cents does it take to pay the school portion of the debt service.
You want to know of that 70%, how much is operational for schools and how much is debt service?
Correct. I would like to see.
We can figure that out for you.
Mm-hmm. Or I would rather break the city debt and the school debt and combine it together. Right now we're showing a 12 cent. I'm going to just throw a fictional number here, 15 cents of the 70 cents if it's going towards the school debt service. Then, you know, you would basically add, you know, looking at the total city debt, because all debt is city debt. There is no school debt. It's all city debt. So all city debt would then show up to be 27 cents.
Hmm.
We can do that both ways and email you the answer.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
May I request that be made a formal part of the minutes, because this is deceiving if the public is watching right now.
Sure.
They're thinking 70 cents is going to the schools for operations, and that is not correct.
Okay, we'll do it both ways and we'll make it a part of the minutes.
Mm-hmm.
I'd recommend not combining the two debt numbers, but rather breaking out the schools into schools operations and schools debt.
Yeah, agreed.
This is why are we breaking out the school debt? We don't break out the police debt, the fire debt, and other debt. Why are we doing that?
But you just commented that the misleading part of the 70 cents.
Mm-hmm.
So if we call out the school debt,
so we could
60, you know, 55, yeah. 15, whatever the number is.
I want to.
What is your point?
That, to your point, that it would give everyone a more true picture as to what that 70 cents equals. I think, to Brian's point, if you put that school debt portion along with the city debt portion, then mm-hmm. you kind of do the opposite, right? Because then you don't.
But it's all city debt. I mean, every bit of it is for the benefit of the residents of Manassas Park.
Okay.
True.
Let us get on with the presentation. Okay. We'll get to these details as we go through the next days of budget calendar.
Next slide shows how the general fund expenditures are broken out. You can see personnel is at 56%, debt is at 13%, legal and insurance 3%, regional services 12%, and operations and maintenance 16%.
I'm sorry, because I got covered up, but this is excluding the schools.
Excluding schools.
So this is city only.
Okay. Any questions about this slide? All right, next we're going into departmental summaries, and this just shows percentage personnel cost to department totals, what the personnel costs are for each department, operations and maintenance, total budget, and for FY16, the percentage increase or decrease for those departments. The next couple slides are the same. These show your just by department, police, fire, public works, services, parks and rec. And then we've got clerk and governing body, manager, commissioner of revenue, treasurer, and then the third one is finance, human resources, registrar, planning, zoning, and information technology.
Hey, Kim, I got a question. Your previous slide. So that 13%. So that 13% of debt, that will increase as the years go by and our debt payments increase.
I believe it increases for the next 2 years and then it actually starts to go down. Is that right, Gary?
No, it remains state, same.
It goes up, stays flat a couple of years, and then starts going down.
Okay. So it'll go up to more than 13%. We've got to keep that in mind as we look in the long term.
The dollar will go up, the percentage is going to depend on our other expenditures.
Right. Right. And regional services, what exactly is that?
Those are the services that we are provided through Prince William County. They include
it's detailed on page 39 of the budget document under tab 3.
Oh, that's all our shared services. I got
the library, sheriff, jail.
Courts, sheriff, community services, mental health, library, cooperative extension, agency on aging.
In our operations and maintenance, is that for the roof that we just paid for, or what is that?
The operations and maintenance is basically everything. Everything else is not here. Any repairs, maintenance, supplies, anything else that's not technically listed as personnel in your departmental budgets.
Mm-hmm. But that would include the roof repair we just did this year, right?
The roof on here?
Yeah.
We actually haven't done that yet, and that's going to be in capital. That's not in general funds.
Okay. Do we have a breakdown of that in the binder as well, Gary? Is that just in general? The operations and maintenance?
You'll see it departmentally in each of the department budgets.
Okay.
Personnel would include salaries, and it's at the top of all the departmental budgets with salaries and FICA, retirement, and all of that, health insurance, and then everything else is going to be operations and maintenance.
Okay. Got it. Thanks.
Okay. The departmental summaries. So here is the summary of all funds. And you can see both the FY15 and FY16. FY15 adopted, FY16 proposed, as well as the dollar and percent increase there. I will tell you that as a part of this budget, we have proposed and put on the revenue side an increase in motor vehicle decal fees, very minimal, and it's what I had emailed you all previously about. They have not been increased in quite some time, and I think long past overdue. The increases for each one, it just amounts to a couple dollars. We've also proposed increasing the cigarette tax from 50 cents to 65 cents. And in addition to the parks and rec fee increases that you approved tonight, we are looking at some other fee increases in parks and rec that have not yet been included in our revenue projections because we're still working out the details of what that looks like. But you know, we haven't stopped looking for places to try to increase our revenues. Yep, that was the last one.
Sorry, on your slides, I don't see any transfers to school. You know,
we are proposing an additional $250,000 in funding for the schools. Where is that in the budget booklet, Gary?
Page 39, under tab 3. And these slides are just an overview of the presentation format. It's not a required format. It's just trying to give you an overview of the finances.
And we can certainly answer any questions that you have about the budget tonight, but I'm sure you're going to want to take some time to go back and look through it. And if you look at the tentative budget schedule that I put on there, I had set aside a variety of days for budget work sessions, and you know, the intent was to maybe break those down by department so that you all could take some time, you know, to look at those as much as you feel like you need to.
So I have a couple of questions, Kim, and like, I'm going to just ask, you know, now. We can follow up on it, you know, later on. The first question is, you know, like actually to Bruce and Krista. When is the school budget going to be adopted, and how does the number here on page number 39 tie into your budget? Is this? Okay.
It's going to be on Thomas Jefferson's birthday, right? It's coming up, their presentation.
Our public hearing is on Monday, next Monday.
Yeah, it's the 13th.
Okay. So you do have a budget in which you have presented, you know, looking to the school board?
Yes, it's posted on the website.
Okay, can I get a copy of it? I haven't had a chance to look through it.
Sure.
Thank you.
Can I get a copy as well? I've seen it. I think it's just a... It's not a line for line budget, though. It's just a press. It's just, can I get a copy of a line by line budget?
Dave, Kim has it.
Oh,
she has her budget line by line.
You know what? I'm going to attend. I have attended last year.
Well,
I'll attend it. I think it's an important thing to attend and to just to listen and get those numbers there.
Okay, Kim, if you have it, can you forward that, please? Because I was actually looking for that line by line.
Sure.
Okay. The next question which I had was for you, Kim.
Mm-hmm.
A couple of months ago, like when I had asked you, you know, when you took over to review all the positions as well as, you know, like when their pay, you know, I wanted to make sure that, you know, our staff is getting, you know, compensated, you know, based on the Northern Virginia region, which is kind of an expensive place to live.
It is.
I just wanted to make sure that, you know, like when you look through it and, you know, like when and made sure that, you know, all our employees are compensated adequately so that, you know, they can live a comfortable living.
To be frank, many of them are not. We need to make some adjustments, but I don't see how we can do it in this budget cycle. It was hard enough to get to a point where this was a balanced budget without a tax decrease, or I'm sorry, without a tax increase. And to get to that point, we still had to do some position eliminations and some restructuring. We have a lot of folks that should be paid more than they are, and we lose a lot of folks because of that. And we lose a lot of folks because we don't provide training opportunities or leadership opportunities that other larger localities can offer. And that is a problem that we're going to consistently face until we are able to address it. But I mean, I can't even give people raises this year, you know?
I understand, you know, but, you know, like, I mean, I think from my perspective, I would like to know, like, I mean, what is the delta, you know, between, you know, like, I mean, what we're currently paying them, which is causing them, you know, like, I mean, maybe take on second jobs or go after, you know, like, I mean, you know, other employment opportunities with other local governments or private sector. So what is the delta, you know, like, I mean, I want to make sure I know what is the delta, and then we can start looking at, you know, trying to meet that delta, you know, like, I mean, cover the gap.
Right.
So is that something in which you'll be able to, like, I mean, share with us over the next couple of weeks?
We certainly can. I know that the HR department has been doing a lot of work. I told her to make looking at the public safety employees in particular a priority to make sure their funding was competitive. So I know she already has a lot of that data and research. And I'm sure Chief Evans has it at his fingertips for you guys if you wanted it tonight. Yes, we can do that. We're not talking about $10,000 or $20,000 though. We're talking about a whole lot more money than that.
Well, I would really like to have that information.
Sure.
So, like, if you can't collect all that and send it to me, I would like to look at it. one of the things in which I would like to make sure that, you know, especially like, I mean, with all the staff, you know, like, I mean, we tend to, like, I mean, you know, focus only on, you know, like, I mean, first responders, but we also want to, like, I mean, focus on, you know, like, I mean, DPW and, you know, social services, all those people, you know, while they are not, you know, like, visible like the police and the fire, but, you know, like, I mean, they're essential as well.
And absolutely. I mean, some of the, you've got a lot of public works employees that are sitting here tonight, and I honestly, when I look at some of their salaries, I don't know how they survive in Northern Virginia. And social services, same way.
Okay. So please, when you get a chance, you know, like, collect that information and send it to the governing body, because at least I'm interested. I think they probably also are.
Okay.
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, Preston, let me just finish this.
My bad. Go ahead.
This schedule, the tentative budget schedule, is there any particular, you know, process you were planning to follow? Because, you know, like, I mean, in the past, what we have done is, you know, we used to have these, you know, budget work sessions where we used to actually meet with many different departments on different days. And I'm just trying to understand, you know, this budget work session on the 14th and the 21st and, you know, 28th, May 5th, any of those things. You know, like, did you have any process? Did you consider any departments?
I had sent this out to you guys about a week and a half ago or so. I haven't really gotten any feedback on it. If there's nothing glaring that, you know, you can't attend or that you're not okay with as far as dates go, then we'll go ahead and set up a schedule and email it back out to you and say, on this day we're going to be talking about these, and this day we're going to be talking about these. I don't know if you guys had a chance to look at this or not.
Yeah, I looked at it. It looks good.
Go ahead and make your assignments, please.
Okay. And I didn't know if you would think that this was way too much. I mean,
I thought this was great.
So what I want to do with the first one is I want to go into a general overview.
Okay.
And then we'll look to see what we need to do beyond that. But let's keep the first one at an overview level.
Okay. And then go into departmental specific
as we would need to.
That.
The general overview may drive specific questions.
Okay.
So that we don't, it'll give the department heads that need some time to look up information or whatever to be prepared for it.
Okay, then I will ask Lana to go ahead and advertise and post these tomorrow. And so you'll be having your first work session next Tuesday then.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments?
No. How much does a cost of living adjustment cost for our city employees? How much would that cost?
I had three different scenarios, and I can actually run and get them in my office if
sure.
you want.
This is well worth it.
Wait.
I have a 0.5 increase. Would be $42,500 across all employees, for all employees, and a 0.5. So, yes.
Here. Let me go grab the scenarios that I pulled together.
Sure. See what we're working with here.
Hey Gary, what's a penny worth on the tax rate again?
For 2016, about 100 with a 6%+ increase, about $142,000.
Thanks.
Got it.
Okay, so the first scenario that I put together was, and actually these are all tiered structure.
Mm-hmm.
The first scenario was employees making less than $60,000 would receive a 3% increase. Employees making between $60,000 and $80,000 would receive a 2% increase. And employees making over $80,000 would receive 1% increase. The amount for that was $177,575.
Look at that.
The second scenario.
Come on. Genius.
Employees under 60 would receive a 2%. Mm-hmm. 60 to 80 would receive 1%. And above 80 would receive 0.5%. And the cost for that was $107,837. And then the third scenario, employees under 60 would receive 2.5%. Between 60 and 80 would receive 1.5%, anyone but above 80 but not a department director would receive 1%. Any department director would only receive half a percent. And the cost for that was $142,874.
Okay. If Gary, have you shopped around in terms of where there are options for where to put the proffer dollars, that $5 million or $5.5 million?
It's part of the budget document.
Okay. Good. Does it have any good interest rates, or are they all mainly low?
How are you talking about investing?
Right.
I've talked with many of them. Again, the interest rates are minimal. They're limited to what we can invest in. Obviously, we can invest in risky investments. So the rates that you get are not... We're getting actually a pretty good rate over at Alliance Bank.
Mm-hmm.
To invest it, we wouldn't get that much more money.
So right now it's sitting in a savings account?
Yes.
And that's at, what, like a 1%?
I think it's dropped down to about 0.5%.
See, I think a money market fund or even a CD might offer a little more than that. And we can make that interest off of that can possibly offset into this one of these three scenarios.
Now, a lot of money markets are 0.4%.
Are they 0.4? Yeah. They're that low?
They're very low.
The Alliance, this, our money sitting there in that checking account is earning 0.45%, I believe.
0.45%. Okay. Well, the good thing is we're using this money. It's being used to make more money safely.
If you guys did decide to go with one of these three scenarios, and when I was looking at them, the one that I was planning on recommending until I saw how bad the budget was the third one. It's the one that's in the middle. You've got one that's a lot closer to 200,000, one that's about 107. The one in the middle was 140 some thousand, and that again would be 2.5 to the lowest paid employees, and then 1.5 between 60 and 80,000. 1% above 80 if not a director, and then directors only 0.5%.
Okay. Hmm.
And it's not that I don't think that the directors are worth it. It's just that we're in Northern Virginia, and it's a lot harder for the lower paid employees to survive.
That's a good point, Kim.
That raise means more to them than it.
That's
so,
good
Kim,
point.
Would you please, you know, email those scenarios, you know?
Hmm?
Can you email those three scenarios in which you just mentioned?
Give the three again?
So can you email them?
Oh, email them, yes, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. They're all in one spreadsheet on separate sheets within the spreadsheet.
Can we come up with ways to reduce that operations and maintenance pie, that 16%? I know we constantly look at that over the years, but to just look at that again, that's a large pie, and I think that's a doable pie if we're going to start up anywhere in terms of trying to come up with savings.
Can I make a comment?
Yes, sure. Absolutely.
I agree with you. It looks large. When you look at the detailed spreadsheets, it's pretty small numbers
right.
In each department.
It really is.
There's not a lot of fluff in there. I mean, you can look at it. Again, mm-hmm. We might could cut a few things, but... in a lot of the operational departments, there's only a couple of $1,000s in operations and maintenance. And the one slide that showed the percentage of personnel to the departments, I mean, most departments are over 90%, 95%. Those that aren't, that O&M is like at parks. There's $200,000 of utilities. The major things are in DPW, we've got fuel, that's about $180,000.
Right.
So most of them are minor, relatively minor things, dues and memberships, a couple of $100, office supplies, a few $100 in each department. The larger items we have cut, and we feel like we've cut as much as we can.
Right.
The directors and colleagues echo that. They get a little worried that, you know, we're cutting too much, but we're, you know, trying to be as frugal as possible. But
okay.
Like I said, one, take a look in the individual departmental spreadsheets. The middle section is operations and maintenance, and you can see the individual lines here.
Okay, I'll be taking a look at that.
So that we've got a lot of business yet to go through tonight. What I'm going to ask the governing body to do is please, you have the budget before you. If you have questions, please get the questions in as you review the document. Copying the governing body to Kim so we can get those moving. And our next meeting will be a general session budget discussion next Tuesday night. If you have specific questions that we want to go ahead and get out that the can let the departments, as you find any things as you go through the budget, let's get those out so the department heads have as much time as they can to respond. Next Tuesday night will be a work session. It's not going to be a formal called meeting, no action. It's going to be purely work session, generally on the budget, and then we'll go from there into what we need to with the departments. With that, if there's nothing else on the budget, we'll go ahead and move forward to closed meeting. City Attorney, do you have a recommendation for us for closed meeting?
Yes, before, sir.
Sorry. Dean, before we go into, I just want to make a quick comment. President, the easiest thing which we could probably do instead of, you know, focusing on the operations and maintenance, you know, I've been saying this for 5 years, you know, like, and we spend $500,000, you know, like, I mean, in the library services agreement, you know, like, you could be taking the $500,000 and give it in pay raises to employees. Every year we keep giving this $500,000, you know, the utilization of library services is minimal. You know, I bring up this issue, and, you know, like, I mean, there is no inaction, you know, like, we stubbornly, like, I mean, stay put, you know, like, when paying for $500,000 in library services, it doesn't get us, you know, we could be using that $500,000, you know, looking to pay decent raises to all our employees.
That's under negotiation, though, right now, correct?
How long? 5 years? You know, it's just keeping on dragging on, you know?
We're getting on the closed meeting material, so I don't want to comment on that yet.
I just want to make one comment. I echo that as well. I'm in favor of withdrawing from the library system, using those funds to redirect half of it to the schools, the rest of it to our operations. I think it is time to put more money into the schools, reduce our class size, and I think the library is only serving about 2% of the population. Our schools are starting to struggle. And I think we need to really consider that.
Okay, I won't comment because right now we're in negotiation, and I don't want to cross that line in terms of what can be mentioned and what can't be mentioned because this is a closed meeting item. But I definitely am listening to you guys.
Would you make our recommendation for a motion, please?
Yes, sir. I recommend the governing body go into closed meeting to discuss the assignment, performance, demotion, and salaries of specific public officers and employees of the city, to protect the privacy of individuals in personal matters not related to public business, and to consult with the city attorney regarding two legal matters requiring the provision of legal advice by the city attorney pursuant to paragraphs 1, 4, and 7, respectively, of subsection 2.2-3711A of the Code of Virginia.
Governing body's pleasure in going into closed meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Motion is second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. We'll go into closed meeting in this room in 6 minutes. That gives everybody a chance for a bio break and for the room to get cleared.
Hey, thanks.
Dean, I was trying to err on the side of caution.
Oh, yeah, I appreciate that. Yeah.